Now, there is an incredible organisation you may have heard of. It's called Clare House. It does some wonderful work, and actually the work that it does is looking to, well, expand and actually touch on more people. And the work that they do, hopefully, will touch more and more lives within a particular surrounding and a particular scenario, something we're going to set out over the course of the next half hour or so. The Clare House Appeal is up and running, and there's a website, clarehouse.org.uk, Clare with an I, which I'll point people in the direction of so they can find out some more information. But we've got a team of people in the studio, including Shannon.
Hello.
Welcome to the studio, Hannah. We've got Lesley Fellows. Lesley, great to see you. And we've got Hayley Smallman. Hayley, great to see you. Thank you for your time. I've got you down, Hayley, as a Clare House mum.
I am. I certainly am.
We're going to be hearing about your interactions with Clare House and the reasons why you're a parent trustee now. Lesley, we're going to hear about the work that you do through Clare House as well. Anna, for people who have been living under a rock, tell us about Clare House. Tell us about the work that it does. Tell us why Clare House is here at the moment.
Well, we've just launched our appeal to reach every dying child yesterday. The reason we're launching our appeal is because we've realised we're only reaching one in two of the children we could be. Now, Clare House looks after seriously and terminally ill children who really need our help. Their families need our help. The children need our help. And with referrals have gone up by 84% in the last 6 years. And we're just struggling to meet the demand. And we know we're not offering the services to every family that we could be.
I guess some people would think, well, you know, you work hard, you fundraise, people have supported Clare House as well. You might think, you know what, we're doing our best in difficult circumstances, and a lot of different organisations have got difficult circumstances. But you're actually saying, no, there are more people who can come to Clare House, and we want those people to have that experience. So you've got this plan for a huge expansion.
And we do really, really value all the support people have offered us over the last 20 years since Clare House has been opened. What we're almost saying, though, is we've been doing such a good job, but we want to do more of it. We know there's a need there. We've got a hospice on the Wirral at the moment, but the hospice on the Wirral is up to capacity right now. What we've seen because of the massive rise in referrals, we just can't cope. We can't keep going on like this. We are doing everything we possibly can to make the most of the resources we've got, to spread it as far as possible. But we're getting to the point where we need more money to employ more nurses and offer more services on the Wirral. But we've also realised that in the long term, we need to build a hospice in Liverpool.
And you've got a site that's picked out already. Just tell us about what you've got planned for West Derby.
Yeah, well, we've been incredibly lucky. We've got a site in West Derby, an amazing site. It's an ex-Carmelite monastery, and it's an incredible site. It's got big gardens, really beautiful. It's a secluded area. But at the moment, all we can offer is daycare to children and families. And what our families really need is 24/7 care, so that their children can come into the hospice, the families can have a break from caring for them. And we also want to be able to offer end-of-life care, which we can't currently at the site in West Derby. So whilst it's a great first step, it's not the lifeline that a lot of our families need.
Yeah, just tell us about the geography of this. People know we're all now West Derby. In terms of areas where people come from to use Clare House's facilities, the distance that families travel, for instance.
Well, we know a lot of families have to travel quite a long way to come to Clare House on the Wirral. And even if a family is coming from Liverpool and it, say, takes 45, 50 minutes to drive, if you've got a seriously ill child, that's really hard. And a lot of families have told us that they're really, really worried of driving through the tunnel in case anything happens to their child. And these are the anxieties they have. And we know from the families who already come to our site on Liverpool, they're much more likely to use it if it's nearby, and it'll be close to Alderhay. So it's really important to them that if their children get really sick, they can go to Alderhay, and equally, we'll just be 10 minutes down the road. So it'll be so much easier for them to get to.
Lesley, let's just bring you in at that point. In regard to that, there's kind of the medical side of thing. You think, great, if you're in a building, great, doesn't matter where it is. But actually, quite clearly, there is more of a community sense around an organisation like Clare House. And you must get a sense of that if families come in and they're flustered and they've travelled a long way, that they don't maybe get the experience that they would otherwise get if they were in a more convenient setting, maybe something a little bit closer to home.
Yeah, so, you know, you asked sort of what sort of areas we cover, and for many of our families, they travel from Cheshire, they travel from parts of North Wales, from Merseyside, from Warrington, so from Wirral, everywhere, all across the Northwest, we have families travelling. And, you know, it is very difficult when you've got a child who's very sick to be able to make that journey. Some of our children don't travel well, so like I say, travelling an hour to Wirral isn't always great for the child and family. And being close to Alder Hey is also very, very important. You know, if you are a Merseyside family, you are very used to having a specialist sick children's hospice on your doorstep, and you have such a great deal of confidence in them. And when they have to travel through to the tunnel, that sort of safety blanket's taken away from them. So being able to, you know, have your support either in your own homes in the community or actually in a site that's very close to you is really, really important to our families.
Can you tell us about the age ranges? We're talking about children here. Tell us about the sort of age ranges that you might be seeing coming through the doors.
Yeah, well, we currently support children from 0 to 23. And I would actually go further than that to say that we're actually picking up babies in the antenatal phase. So a lot of our you know, colleagues at the Liverpool Women's are referring mums when they've been diagnosed antenatally with a really, really sick child. And we're able to support them throughout their pregnancy and actually come up with some kind of plan for the birth, for whatever that may be, whether their child lives a little while or whether they die. And we're able to make sure that whatever time they've got with their baby, we make it the best it possibly can be. If the child does go on to live at that point, we will support them for however long that may be. So, you know, children are referred at any point during their sort of palliative care journey. And we really, really pride ourselves in making a difference to families when and where they need it.
You must see that so often, families who've used Clare House for whatever reason and have had a positive, maybe a negative outcome, that they stay around the place, that they stay part of the Clare House family.
Yeah. So whenever a child and family are referred to Clare House, you know, we class them as our family for years and years to come. You know, families really sort of take them into our, well, we almost become their extended family. And, you know, some children we support for hours, some days, some weeks and some years. And we do have some families that actually started coming to Clare House when we first opened. So that's 20 years ago. And we've had the privilege to be able to support their child throughout their whole child's life, which is lovely to see.
Well, clarehouse.org.uk, you can find out more information about the new appeal. And I can ask you about this. The hashtag is Every Dying Child. Now, for some people, they might think that's a harsh sounding hashtag. You know, of course, it's something which will really strike home with people, though. But we are talking, you know, serious care, you know, seriously ill children, terminally ill children as well. We're talking about end of life care. So we've almost got to embrace the work that's going on. And actually, if we are talking about dying children, then let's talk about it and let's make sure that the facilities are there for them.
I mean, we know the name of the appeal is shocking to a lot of people, and we don't want to upset people. But at the same time, what we do want to make people realise is there are dying children out there who aren't getting any support. They're not having the chance to make memories with their families. They're not having the chance to get the support that Clare House can offer. And so whilst we're sorry if we're upsetting people, what we're trying to do is tell the truth. And what you might see out and about in Liverpool, we've got some statements on billboards, and their statements, they are, again, shocking. There's one, for example, that a parent said in that there's no manual to tell you what to do when your child dies. Now, that's awful. Who wants to think that? Who wants to even go there? But this was said by a family who came to Clare House, and Clare House was actually there for them to support them with the funeral arrangements, to help offering counselling to the other brothers and sisters and help them in the long run to cope with the death of their child. Now, this is something we don't want to force people to think about all the time, but we want to say those families are out there and we all should be doing our best to support them.
Absolutely. And I think people will hear those statements and read those statements and they'll think they are pretty stark. And again, people don't go out of their way thinking this is going to be at the forefront of my minds. But actually, for you guys, this is at the forefront of your minds, because this is the reality. And this is happening in the world, now happening in Liverpool too. Clarehouse.org.uk is the website. We've got Hannah Shannon in the studio, Lesley Fellows as well. We're going to be speaking to Hayley Smallman in just a couple of moments' time here on the home of Rock, Sport and Talk, Radio City Talk. Just gone 1:45, Radio City Talk. My name is Mick Coyle. We've got the team from Clare House with us in the studio this hour. We've got Hannah. We're hearing about their new campaign. They're going to be opening up a new facility here in Liverpool. They've got the building already. They've got an appeal to pay for the work that they want to take place there. We'll hear about the costs associated with it and when the hospice itself will be up and running exactly as they want it to be doing in West Derby, of course, remaining on the Wirral as well. We heard from Lesley, who is a nurse consultant. Let's bring Hayley into the conversation as well. Hayley, thank you for your time. Hayley Smallman. Tell us about when you first stepped through the door of Clare House. You're a Clare House mum.
I am. Yes. Yeah, I am. Holly is 16 now. So we've been going to Clare House for 16 years. The first moment I walked through the door of Clare House, I just felt that it was the place that we belonged. And that's really the only thing I can describe, because when you've got a child with a life-limiting illness and you go home and you've been dealt this completely devastating news, you almost feel quite completely on your own and you just don't know where to turn. You don't know what to do. You know, I think when you're pregnant, you have all these aspirations and hopes when you're planning your child. And then your child is born and your life is turned upside down within a second. So for us, we were then obviously signposted over to Clare House. As a mum, it was quite scary at first to think, oh, we're going to a hospice, you know, with my little girl. But, you know, the reality is that that was the only place where we could go, where we belonged and where we could get what we needed.
In terms of that, that idea that at the moment there are families who need that experience but can't access that experience, as somebody who has had that experience, you must have seen the value in it, the reasons why every family who needs this service can get the service.
Oh yeah, and it's really hard for me to kind of equate or even articulate what they do for us, because it's unimaginable for people who don't live our lives. Your child is so ill, you can't leave your house most days, you're caring 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, you know. The luxury of just going for a shower some days doesn't even, you know, for my other children, having time with me, to be able to sit with them, all little things that family life is generally about. For us, it's a real massive task. So for us then to go over to Clare House and they support us and give us that little window of normality is fabulous for us. When this appeal launched, obviously, you know, it took me back, you know, every dying child, because most families like myself will look at the child and, you know, we say, no, we're not dying, we're living. But the reality of our life is that our time is limited with our children. And as a mum, I think that I want to do the best in death that I can do for Holly, as I have done in her life. So I wanted to have the same quality, and to be able to talk openly about that, in to be able to talk about your worst fears as a parent and go to a safe space where people understand and people know what to do, that to us is invaluable.
What's that feeling like where you go in with you know, the diagnosis and you step through the door for the first time and straight away you meet people who say, don't worry, I've got this? And they get it and they understand that. That feeling, I guess, the sense of relief, but obviously it's tainted by everything else that's going on as well. But a sense that there is something there. There are a group of people there who kind of get what you're going through.
I think it's almost like a bit of a, I call it like a big emotional cuddle, really. And it's kind of like, it's okay. It's going to be okay. And as much as I know that in my heart, it's not going to be okay, because ultimately, no one can make my little girl better. And that is the only thing that I, you know, would wish for above anything. But it's going to be okay. We're going to walk alongside you with your journey, no matter how long it is. And we're going to be there for the highs, for the lows. And we're going to support you. And we're going to make sure that everything is as okay as it can be.
I guess, Lesley, you know, that's not just about medical care, is it? That's social care. It's friendship. It's almost, I'm going to use the word love. That you've got to use in this mix. Now, you train, you know, I guess, for the medical side of things, but I guess you've got to learn the social care, the friendship.
Yeah, I think any nurse that comes to work for a children's hospice comes in for a very different reason. You know, I think we are very highly skilled in caring for the real complex children that come to Clare House. And, you know, I think that for me, I've worked at the hospice for 15 years now, and that has changed significantly. We're continuously training from a medical side to keep up up with medical technology to allow the children to live longer and to have a really good quality of life. But you're right, you know, being able to, you know, get down on your knees and really play with a child, be able to really interact with them positively, to be able to, you know, really take care of their parents, their siblings, their grandparents, everyone in the whole family. You know, that doesn't always come naturally to everyone, but that is something that we really pride ourselves within the hospice, that, you know, we don't just take care of the child, it's the whole family.
Yeah, because that really comes across, you know, that idea that, you know, families might go away, leaving the child with you guys, go and have a day and then come back that day, yeah, whenever it would be, yeah, and pick up that child. And I guess you'd be able to see in that family's eyes that they've had a day, an experience. Not, yeah, to say that they were looking to, you know, get rid of the child for the day, but no, actually they've just had that moment, yeah, of respite.
It is. It's so lovely. You know, when we first meet a family for the first time, obviously trust is the biggest thing. You know, they've got a real special child that is absolutely individual, and parents know their child the best. So we need to work alongside their parents to understand their child and make sure that we can provide the care that they want us to deliver. And that takes time. So it's great to work alongside the families in them early years. And then you get such a sense of pride almost when that mum says for the first time, do you know what, we're going to leave our child with you at Clare House, because you know they really implicitly trust you to look after their child. And it might be that, you know, as Hayley sort of has already alluded to, just going out for a date with your husband and having a meal, you know, being able to go to the cinema with a child where it's really difficult to get through, you know, doors and, you know, stairs with wheelchairs when you've got lots of medical technology that you have to take around. It's bringing that little bit of normality back for them families.
Is that part of your job now, Hayley, that actually you must see those parents stepping in the door for the first time? Do you have to go up to go, look, I've been stood in the exact spot where you are, and don't worry.
Oh, 1,000,000%. And I think, as Lesley's just said, this trust, this building of this relationship, it's a two-way partnership that, you know, people... We can't just go to our mums and dads and say, oh, can you mind the grandkids? You know, can we leave them for a night? And as Lesley said about, you know, leaving them, we've had a really difficult year with Holly this year. You know, we've been in critical care for a long time. So Holly's needs have, you know, grown beyond anything that we've ever imagined. We've had to deal with new scenarios, and I'm 16 years down the line and I am still really scared. And I mean, I picked up the phone the other day and cried my eyes out till I had no more tears left in me, and I said to Lesley, I need a break, I need to come away from the situation. And for me, that guilt that I felt saying that, but it's the enormous pressure that we're living under day in, day out, making these really quite life-changing decisions, really, for our children. You know, we make a mistake and our children mightn't be here then within the next hour. So when we get new families through the door, it's lovely to be able to say to them, you know, listen, trust me, I promise you, you know, that you will move on your journey. And in a year's time, you'll be going out with your husband, you'll be having that meal out, and you'll be sitting there with a glass of wine each and enjoying them few hours that you've got.
If you want to find out more information about Clare House, clarehouse.org.uk, Clare with an I. If you want to find out more information there, if you just type Clare House into any search engine, probably Google, you'll get that as the first option there, all the details of the appeal. Hannah, can we do the brass tacks on this one? You're looking to raise money. It's an appeal. You've got the new building, but you need to do the adaptations to that building. Have you got a bill? Have you got a builder with a quote?
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, we know even without a building, we urgently need more funds so we can look after more children. But we know in the long term, we want a hospice in Liverpool. We've worked out this is going to cost around £40 million to build. I know that sounds a lot of money, but the kind of medical care that we're offering children is incredibly complex. So we've got to have all the best medical equipment. We've got to be able to look after the children 24 hours a day. And also, we've not only got to build it, but we've got to keep it going. It's so important to the children of Liverpool that these facilities are available. So we know it's a lot of money to raise. To be honest, if we had the money, we would start building straight away, but we haven't. So we're calling out to the people of Merseyside, and we know people are incredibly generous. People have supported us for the last 20 years. We're saying, please, can you help us a little bit more? Because we know that Liverpool needs a new children's hospice.
In terms of piggy banks, £40 million is a lot to find in them as well. People might think, well, maybe I can't donate that much, but maybe there's something I could do volunteering or things like that. Are there any other ways that people can help out?
Yeah, every little bit makes a massive difference. So, I mean, you can do anything you want to do for us. We are more than happy to have your support. Anything from any pennies that you've got in your purse and you can give to us, that's brilliant. And if you haven't got any money, why not volunteer for us? We've got shops around the area. If the shops can only keep going because we've got volunteers in them. If you've just got a few hours you can give a week, that will make a massive difference. If you want to give some clothes to our shops, for example, that will make a difference. Just give the leftovers from your wardrobe, the things you haven't worn for the last couple of years, and we can sell them. We can make money that will go directly to helping reach more children.
If you want to find out more information about the appeal, all over social media, we've got the links up on our social media too, www.clarehouse.org. Hannah, thank you for your time today. Great to see you. Lesley, thank you for your time too, for joining us on the programme. And Hayley, thanks for sharing your story too here on Radio City Talk. And we're going to get the copy of the interview up on social media. So if you want to share it with your friends and turn that around on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, wherever it is, we'll get all the links up through our social media. We are at Radio City Talk.